Good morning, everybody. How y'all doing?
All right.
Okay, good. Good to have y'all. Glad to see everybody here today. We're going to get started with a word of prayer. Everybody stand up. Let's pray. And then we'll get going with some music. Dear Lord, we thank you for giving us this chance to be in your house, God. We thank you for the preparing of the word that you gave the pastor and the preparing of the music you gave the worship team, God. And we thank you for giving us this ability to be in your house just to worship you freely, Lord. We thank you for everything that you've done and everything that you will do in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. Everybody look around right quick. Just look around.
That's not much looking, I'm telling you. Just find somebody and look at them. Just a second.
Now, how good and pleasant was that? Well, it was. You don't have to say anything. All right, here's one line from the scripture. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together.
Thank you. Empty place, if not for grace.
to delay. If not for your grace, so precious Lord, please take my hand, just lead me on and let me stay. A hopeless case, I was a guilty place. Sing it again. So precious Lord, please take my hand, just lead me on, oh, and let me stand. And the hopeless case, I was an empty place, if not for grace. You see through eyes of love, I hope this case, I was an empty place, if not for grace. Precious Lord, so precious Lord, please take my hand, just leave me on. Let me stand, a hopeless case, an empty place, if not for grace. It was amazing grace, it was amazing grace. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, I once was lost, oh, now I'm found. I was alone. I was a hopeless case, I was an empty place, if not for your grace, Lord. Oh, I was a hopeless case, an empty place, if not for grace.
Well, if you're thankful for grace, come on and lift your voice up and let the Lord know that you're thankful that His blood reached you, His blood saved you. Your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life because of His sacrifice on the cross. Thank you for grace. I don't deserve it, but thank you. I'm not worthy of it, but thank you for grace. Thank you for grace. I was lost, I was dead in my trespasses and sins, but because of His grace and His mercy, I get to stand up here and tell you how good God is. Would you say amen? Wow, good looking crowd today. Glad to have all of our visitors this morning. I'm going to get in trouble, but I'm going to do it. And glad to have Mike and Eileen with us today. That's Larry's brother and sister-in-law over here. Good to have them. And I saw the family walk in, and my goodness, you fill up a section, don't you? We're so glad to have you this morning. Come on, give them a faith welcome. Let them know we appreciate them so, so very much. Glad to have Wendell in service. You say, well, Wendell's always here. No, we got two Wendells in the church. I'm glad to have Wendell. Give him a faith welcome this morning. Now, he normally does not look that good, but when he stands beside Dina, he really shines, doesn't he? That's like all of us, man. We don't look that good until we stand beside our wives. Amen. And then we just shine, don't we? Amen. While you're standing, let me impose on your feet for just a second. How many of you honestly believe that America needs a great awakening? Man, this world's in trouble. And the only hope the world has is the Church of the Living God. I believe that. We have the remedy for everything that's wrong with the world. I got a letter from our general superintendent, as well as all of the Assemblies of God ministers did. And he's asking all of the pulpits in the Assemblies of God to stand with Bishop Charles E. Blake, who's the superintendent of the Church of God in Christ, pastors a dynamic church there in Los Angeles, no, San Diego. And to ask us to pray for all of the racial issues that are seemingly in the spotlight today. And I don't know where you stand on this, but listen to me. I was raised in the Delta, and I was raised by a white grandmother who taught me manners, and they taught me respect for everyone. It didn't matter if I didn't say yes, ma'am, to a white woman, if I didn't say yes, ma'am, to a black lady, I got slapped. I was taught when you walk into the room, you simply address everybody and say hello. And my grandmother in Gula, Arkansas, worked with different ethnic groups in that little old town. And I think that as Faith Assembly, this church demonstrates love, and we don't care what color you are. I don't care if you're... What I don't like is the slur names, the racial names that goes along with color. I can't stand it. Makes my toes itch. Amen. And nobody likes to be segregated according to their color. And with the recent issues in Ferguson and then in New York, I'm asking you to demonstrate your love and your grace by joining hands with your neighbor next to you, and we're going to pray that America would awaken in these racial issues. Listen to me. If you make heaven, there will not be white or black or yellow or green. And the only reason all of us get there is by the color of red, the blood of Jesus. And Pike County does not need a white church, and it doesn't need a black church or an Indian church. It needs the church that simply welcomes everyone and says, God loves you no matter what. And I want us to pray as a church family and agree with the Church of God in Christ. Because whether you realize this or not, the Assemblies of God and the Church of God in Christ both came out of the Azusa Street meeting by a godly man who just happened to be an African American, William Seymour. And I'm just glad I'm here. Amen. And I want us to pray for just a few moments that God will begin to move by His Spirit and touch hearts and save those that need to be saved because of race issues. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm thankful that I have an opportunity to lead our church into an area that seems to be divided. There will be no division, Father, at Faith Assembly, and there should be no division in the pulpits of America. Those that are named and call upon the name of Jesus, I'm asking for divine intervention. I'm asking that by the Spirit of the Lord, Holy Spirit, that you'll begin to move in congregations to make a difference and invite and welcome anyone that walks through the door. They don't have to shout. They don't have to lift their hand. They don't have to sing out loud, Father, but they should all be welcomed, rich or poor, tall or short, white or black or red or yellow, makes no difference. And may the doors of Faith Assembly always be open to anyone and everyone who needs help, because the name of the Lord is a strong tower and we need help. We are believing you to close the gap of racial issues. Those that are feeding off of that hate, we curse the hate in the name and in the light of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we are to be children of love and children of forgiveness and children of mercy and children of prayer. So we offer up this prayer today that you would begin to move by your Spirit and help unite our country, that we can get along and love one another. And I claim it in the name of Jesus. And if you believe God just loves everybody, Everybody, would you put your hands together and let the Lord know that we're thankful for His grace. I'm thankful. Amen. You can be seated for just a few moments. If that offends you, well, take it to God in prayer. I saw a post by my friend, pastor in Tennessee. I can say, and I've seen several pictures of little children hugging each other. Racism isn't born, it's taught. It's taught. And I'd rather teach love than I would hate. Amen. I'll preach right there. Don't y'all mess with me. I'll preach right there. I'll drop it while it's hot. Amen. Well, the word anyway. Amen. Let me make a couple of announcements. Can I pose on the praise band? You already got a special ready to go for the offering? You already got one? Oh, never mind. Man. I like that freedom song y'all did that the crowd jumped in there and helped you sing it. Freedom? Can y'all work that one up? That's not in the schedule, but y'all just work with me for a minute. Let me announce, coming up next Sunday, you know what next Sunday is? Children's Christmas program. I have just a little ring in my microphone, Chester. Children's program, and man, you should have heard these kids singing Wednesday night. They did good. Of course, I was up here singing with them, that's why. They did a wonderful job, and I am looking forward to our children putting on a Christmas program next Sunday, and you don't want to miss it, and it's going to be a great time for the entire family. Also, immediately after the service today, we have a Sunday school departmental meeting, leadership meeting. If you're going to help us launch Sunday school the first Sunday in January, all the leaders and teachers at Peggy, where are you at, Peggy? Okay, there she is in the back. How could I miss it with two flags? if you're going to teach a class, it's just mandatory that you're here so that we can get this launched off successfully. I love Sunday school, and I believe we ought to have Sunday school. Amen. You say, but Pastor, I have to get up an hour early and be here an hour earlier. Well, you don't complain about getting that check because you have to be at work on time. Come on, get some teaching, and then I'll yell at you when you get in here. Amen. So right after the service this morning, Sunday school meeting, and let me just make an advance note that Wednesday, the 17th and the 24th, there will be no midweek services in observance of Christmas and New Year's. So put that on your calendar. And we appreciate it so very much. Amen. Well, how many of you know what time it is now? It's time to bring your tithe and your offering to the Lord. How many of you believe that God loves to bless you? God loves to bless me. God loves to bless me. He's just in love with me. He said, he told me I'm a little heavy, but I'll work on that the first of the year. Amen.
Amen.
Great impression, huh, visitors? Amen. Great impression. You see how they are. Amen. We love each other. We have to. Amen. Amen. But just remember that. Get your tithe and your offering ready. And also, this Wednesday night, let me just tell you that we have cafe area at 5:15 to 6:15. Come and get some food and some fellowship on Wednesday night. And it's good eating. Amen. Stand with me. Amen. Hold your tithe and your offering up. Get it up. Get it ready. I'm going to speak our declaration over us, and we're going to worship freely. Father, in the name of Jesus, as we bring in today's tithe and offerings and over and above giving, we are believing you for a supernatural release of your favor over every area of our lives. Some of us need jobs and better jobs. I'm believing you for checks in the mail, inheritances, secure investment, scholarship, creative ideas. Someone told me the other day, said, Pastor, when you started praying for creative ideas started coming to me. We're believing you for finding money, healing for our spirit, soul, and our body. Deliverance to the captive, salvation to the lost. I'm believing you for an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. We are blessed and we will be a blessing to others. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, come on, bring your offering to the Lord. Amen.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is healing. There is life. There is joy.
give God a shout of victory in the house. Come on, give God a shout of victory in the house. Hallelujah. My soul's shouting this morning. But sometimes it's not just my soul that should be shouting. It should be my hands and voice and everything. Come on, lift your hands and give God a praise. Hallelujah. Just because I love you. Just because you've done so much for me. Just because I had nowhere to go. At the cross is where I first saw the light. And the burden of my heart rolled away. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Say, I don't know, Pastor. This worship makes me nervous. You really gonna be nervous when you make it to heaven. I've got to do something though. Shift the gear. Come here. I want to introduce you to my wife, Sister Dana. Come here, Sister Dana. Y'all don't know her, but y'all know her, but the visitors don't know her. Can y'all see her real good? Can y'all see her real good? Yeah. Man, I haven't seen shoes like that since the 70s. Amen. Last time I saw somebody wearing shoes like that, they had makeup on, had a star on one eye. No, I'm just picking on her. I just had to show her off. Had to show y'all her boots. I think they're cool. If she's wearing them, they're cool. They hip. Amen. Amen. I just wanted to showcase you, Jane Garlis. All you men, all you young boys, when a lady's exiting the platform, y'all, you young men ought to be here to help a lady down. And all the ladies said amen. 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 Grab your Bible while you're standing up and turn to Luke's gospel. We're going to go to Luke chapter number 1, I believe it's where we're going to begin this morning. Y'all watch her. Amen. Luke chapter 1, we've been in a 3-week theme series talking about Christmas in Children's Church. You're dismissed. You say, Pastor, after almost two months of ministry, you ought to be used to this. But I get caught up wanting to shout and preach. I just forget it. So, amen. Luke chapter 1, verse 26, if you have it, say amen. If you don't, say wait a minute. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, "But how can this happen? I'm a virgin." The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but now she's in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." And the angel left her. Now, chapter 2, verse 10. We read this last week, but I just want to touch up on it one more time. Chapter 2, verse 10. But the angel reassured them, "Do not be afraid." He said, "I will bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem in the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find the baby wrapped snugly and stripped of cloth, lying in a manger." Would you say amen? Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Come on, let's pray and let's get into the word this morning. Father, words can't describe my appreciation. But I'm asking you now as we shift gear that you'll help me, that your anointing begin to rest upon me. Let me encourage somebody in the word of God. Someone struggling with a Christmas season, the holiday is upon us and they're struggling. May I encourage them through your word. That Father, I thank you that lives are going to be changed and impacted. Deliverance, freedom is going to occur today because your anointing destroys the yoke. And I'm asking you for that anointing and lives to be changed in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to share for just the next few minutes this thought, Christmas hooked on a feeling. Hooked on the feeling, because it seems as if today Christmas has become more of a feeling. Well, I don't feel Christmassy. You know, I don't feel like shopping and I don't feel like buying gifts. And I was reading some funny letters online. Letters to Santa Claus, and one little boy wrote, said, "Dear Santa, will you come to my house? There'll be cookies for you, but if you're real hungry, you can use our phone to order a pizza to go." Little boy said, "Dear Santa, I'm not going to ask for a lot. Here's my list. I want an Etch-a-Sketch animator, pack of number 2 pencils, a Crayola fat marker, and for the big gift, my own color TV. You can drop the pencils if you want to. I don't want to be selfish." Little boy, 4-year-old, said, "Dear Santa, I'll take anything. I haven't been that good." Like the man who bought his wife a diamond ring for Christmas. His friend said, "Well, I thought she wanted a new SUV. He said, "She did, but I couldn't find the fake Jeep." You'll get that in a minute. Amen. Little boy wrote a letter to God and said, "God, I've been good for 6 months." He thought about it. He said, "No, that's not true." He scratched that out. He said, "Lord, I've been good for 3 months." He said, "No." He scratched that out. He said, "God, I've been good for 2 weeks." He said, "No, that won't work." Goes over to the table that had the nativity scene on it. Grabs the Mary figurine. Said, "God, if you ever want to see your mother again." I want to share some things this morning to help us get some things back in focus, because I want to tell you, Christmas is not a feeling. Christmas is a fact. And just because feelings may not, life may not feel so good right now, I can tell you that if you'll get some things back in focus, you can get your feelings in check with the Word of God. And hopefully by the end of the service, I can give us an opportunity to receive the gift of Jesus, because with Jesus, you'll have the best Christmas ever. With Jesus, everything just is better. With Jesus, life is better. Even though it may be difficult, I don't understand people who can go through life without serving God. I don't understand how people make it without a church family and a church pastor and an environment that's going to help them in their faith with God. And so I hope, you know, this Christmas we begin to look at things in the right perspective, because if we don't get a back to the root of the gospel and back to the true meaning of Christmas, life is just going to go bad anyway. Life is tough anyway. So I would rather face life with God in my life than I would without Him. See, Christmas time is so special. Not just because it's the birth of Christ. That is the reason for the season. But what I love about this season is that there's a spirit of generosity. I love to give. I love to receive. I love to bless my wife. I love to bless my children. Love to be a blessing to other people. There's a spirit of giving and a spirit of peace. But at the same time, there's also a spirit of selfishness. And people receive more than they give. You know, we dream of living in a perfect world. One man wrote an article, and he described what the perfect world to him would be. He said, in a perfect world, you would feel as good at 60 as you did at 17, and you would be as smart at 60 as what you thought you were at 17. He said, in a perfect world, professional athletes would be complaining about teachers and police officers making and signing multi-million dollar contracts. Give me an amen, Brother Chris. Amen. I hope you sign a multi-million dollar contract. Amen. I didn't hear, but I assume Jeannie said amen, me too. He said, in a perfect world, potato chips would have calories, but when eating them with dip, the dip would neutralize the calories. He said, in a perfect world, the mail will always come early and the check from the mail will always exceed than what you expected. He said, in a perfect world, ice cream would be good for the heart, apple pie would prevent cancer, and cheesecake would make you lose weight. I like that world. Bring me a piece of apple pie a la mode. Amen. But while that's not going to be a perfect world, the birth of Jesus was perfect. For the word of God said in Galatians 4:4, but when the time had fully come, God sent his son born of a woman. Another translation said, when the right time had come. So there's a perfect timing. And the timing was perfect when Jesus came. Because when you read the scripture, you'll find that there was no war going on at that time. One of the few times throughout the entire word of God, you'll read that there was peace in the land. And the Bible said that at that time, the Romans were in charge and they were ruling the land. And you've heard the saying, all roads lead to the Roman. Why is that? Because they built the road and the highways, and they built all civilization could now be reached because of the Roman ingenuity to build road. That's number one. No war going on. But secondly, there had been 400 years of silence. No prophetic voice in the land from Malachi to Matthew. It had been silent. The prophetic voice had been shut off, and the world looking for the Messiah. And that's the perfect timing that God sent his son. I need to stand here and tell you this morning that if America is going to have a fresh awakening, there has got to become again a prophetic voice in the pulpit, and get Jesus back in the pulpit. If we get Jesus in the pulpit, I'm telling you, lives are changed. That's the perfect timing. If you can't give me a better amen than that, I'll take a Church of Christ nod. Amen. The timing is right. The gift is right. There's no wrong time to accept Jesus. There's no wrong time to get your life in order. There's no wrong time to give God all of your problems and your issues and your worries and your fear. For the Bible said his son was sent to redeem us from the law. From the law of what? The law of religion, the law of ritualism. I can't stand a stopped up church, amen. Because when I got saved from the old honky tonk, I didn't mind going to a strange woman and asking her, because I sure didn't ask no strange man to dance. I didn't have any problem going up to a lady and asking her to dance. And now that I'm saved and redeemed from the law, I'm telling you, I don't have any problem giving God any praise and say thank you. Now, just for my personality, that's how I express myself. You don't have to that way. You can sit there and get as much from God sitting there. That's fine. We welcome all of it. As long as you don't mind me shouting and dancing over your shoe, we're going to get along fine. But when it gets out of order, I can handle that. You say, well, how do you know when it's out of order? Well, when people start barking like a dog, that's out of order. So the timing is right. The gift is right. He redeemed us from the law. I know there are going to be celebrations this Christmas. We've already had some. My wife cooked Friday night for the dinner, the board and the staff, and man, she put it down. Man, we had Brother Wendell cook the turkey. We baked the ham. She made broccoli casserole, potato casserole, corn, green beans, I mean desserts. I mean, it was absolutely wonderful. We had a good time. We're celebrating. But let me tell you something. We got to get back to believing in miracles, in the miracles of Christmas morning, every Sunday, every day of the week. Let's not wait till December or till Walmart starts putting out the ornaments and the Christmas tree before we start getting Christmas minded. Every day that I wake up and I've got breath in my body, it is a reminder that I have Christ in me. I'm not perfect, but my Savior is perfect. Amen. The righteousness that he has been imputed to me. And so, you know, we serve a God that wants to give us miracles every day. I'm talking about the coming of our Savior in a crisis-filled world. And I'm telling you, Ferguson, Missouri needs Jesus right in the heart of that situation. New York needs Jesus right at the heart of that situation. And while so many is, you know, blaming white folk and black folk and all of that, let me tell you something. Quit pointing fingers, because it's not. It doesn't have anything to do with race or color. There's sin in this old world, and the only remedy for sin is the cross. It is the cross. It is Christ in Christmas. But today, Christmas is all about feelings, how you feel. I want to watch Christmas movies. I love Christmas movies. My favorite Christmas movies, I got two of them. It's A Wonderful Life. Man, you can't get better than Jimmy Stewart. It's a Wonderful Life. And then my other one is Christmas Vacation, Clark Griswold. I love it. I love Clark Griswold. Amen. Amen. The lights and everything. Come on, bump your neighbor and say, come on, get your lights up. Amen. I love to watch it. My wife hates both of those movies. Just the Griswold. But she's going to get saved and sanctified one of these days, and she's going to love it. Amen. I love it. I watch it. I've already watched it several times, and I've got them all on my computer in my office, and I watch them in between studying and say, well, how come you're not studying? Well, I do, but the Christmas movies motivate me to keep studying. We want to watch Christmas movies, shows to make us feel good. I hear it all the time. Pastor, I don't feel Christmassy. I don't feel like shopping, and I don't want to buy anything or decorate or bake anything. But you feel better when you find out that Christ is a reason for giving. And all of this season is not about feeling. It's a fact. And I don't know how it happened, but somebody has slipped in and replaced the fact that Jesus is a reason for this season, and they replaced it with a feeling. You're supposed to feel good. You're supposed to feel like all of this giving and all of this blessing, you're supposed to do it. But listen to me, Jesus' birth is not a feeling, it is a fact. We've even lost the statement Merry Christmas. Now you got to replace it with Happy Holidays. And I called somebody the other day. I was on the phone, and they were very kind and courteous. And at the end of it, I know they can't say it, because it's become taboo to say Merry Christmas, because they've got Christ in the mus. And so they said, well, at the end of the conversation, well, Happy Holidays. And Grace was sitting there, and I had them on the speakerphone, so she heard me when I said this back. He said, Happy Holidays. I said, Merry Christmas. You on my nickel, I'm going to say Merry Christmas. Amen, somebody. You say, well, Brother Ronnie, you might offend somebody. Well, I can't help it. I'm not making any apologies for it. I'm saved because of Jesus. I'm sanctified because of Jesus. I'm filled with the Holy Spirit because of Jesus. Everything that I've become and everything I hope to become will be because of Jesus. It's not a feeling, it's a fact. And he does make me feel good at times, but there are some times when I don't feel anything. But what I do is stay at the foot of the cross and say, this too shall pass. And before it's all over with, what the devil meant for my bad, God's gonna turn it around and make it for my good. Can I have an amen, anybody? What are you talking about, Pastor? There's a Savior that was born that's greater than a Merry Christmas. A Savior has been born. I love Jesus. I'm a Jesus freak. I'm a Jesus nut. Because y'all, I tell you a little bit of my history, but you don't really know where I was, and I don't have time to do it this morning. But I'm telling you, the greatest heist that had ever been pulled over history is that Christmas is not a fact, it's a feeling. And because of that hoax, many people at this time of the year are left feeling hollow and empty, and they don't feel Christmassy. You don't feel like celebrating. You don't want to go anywhere. You don't want to go to a party, and you don't want to hug nobody or be hugged. People are entertaining thoughts of suicide and depression and bankruptcy because you don't have gifts under the tree. A lot of people this morning are single. They're divorced. They're feeling all alone and unloved. I don't feel festive. I feel like a failure. My tree doesn't have a lot of things under it. There's pretense and pettiness and pressure and pandemonium, and my eyes are bright and cheery, but the road shot from crying and blood shot from crying. My heart isn't happy. My heart isn't joyful. My heart is hollow and dark. But I don't know what it is for you today. But I can tell you, even me, I'm thinking of the loss of my father and the loss of my biological father and the loss of my loved ones. They're not here this Christmas. I told Dana just yesterday, I believe it was, so much has changed. I'm older. She's older. I look good. She looks great. Amen. But I go back 28 years, and when I had my all of the relatives there, and they're not here. They're in heaven worshiping Christ. But even if you don't feel anything, you got to sign an amen to what I'm saying. I've come to tell you, you've got some good news this morning. And the good news is this. Jesus came all the way from glory just to let you know that he loves you that much, to come and to help you when life doesn't give you any help. Why are you screaming, preacher? I'm not screaming yet. Let me get warmed up. I feel good. I feel good. Down in my soul. I came to preach about Jesus. When I start preaching on Jesus, I can't help but get a little happy. I can't help but find a little soul when I talk about how good my God is. And sometimes, like I said, I don't feel like I'm saved. There are times when I don't feel victorious. There are times when I don't feel like I'm praying through. But there have been times when I just keep on pressing on anyway. And I find that sooner or later, that battle's going to end. And if I just keep clinging to the cross on a hill far away, stood and old. And if you just keep holding on, you'll get past the feeling and you'll get back to Jesus. See, Jesus isn't a feeling, he's a fact. The fact is there's hope for the hopeless. That's a fact. The fact is there's joy for the hurting. There's love for the unloved. There's healing for the sick. Forgiveness for the condemned. Salvation to the lost. Why? Because there was a little baby born on a chilly night in Bethlehem of Judea. He didn't come on a feeling. He came on a fact. The Bible said, God the Father said, men are lost and they're going to die in their sin. Excuse me, I feel like hooping. And Jesus said, Lord, if I don't go, because can't nobody else do it. That's why I sing the song, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Jesus came on a fact that I can and I will be the absolute perfect sacrifice for them. I am the one that can go through all of Malachi can't do it. Isaiah won't fulfill it. David can't do it, even though he was a praiser. He said, but Father, if you'll send me, I will be the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. I can save Dana. I can save Grace. I can save Wendell. I can save Wendell. I can save Dina. And y'all know she so needs it. Amen, somebody. Don't do that. You'll have some feeling with a amen. I was laying in bed one time and made Dana mad at me. About that time, I felt something bite me in the eye. And I woke up and she got mad. She punched me in my eye. She said, pow. She just tagged me. I woke up. I said, what in the world? She said, something bite you too? Something bit me. I said, man, I don't know what it was. See, Christmas is about God loving you. And you say, well, if Christmas is for the broken and the alone and the hurting and the hated, leave me off of that invitation. But that's my point. We've missed the real meaning of Christmas anyway. We've turned Christmas into a Hollywood premiere. We have forgotten the reason for his coming. But Luke 4:18 tells me the reason why he's coming. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He said to who? He said to the poor. Not just the financially poor, but those who feel like there's no hope. I've got news for you, good news. He sent me to tell you that, you know, that the reason he came is so that he could and Ronnie can proclaim to the captive that you can get out. You can be freed. You don't have to stay bound up any longer. I'm telling you, for 17 years, sticking needles in my arm, tripping on LSD, hallucinogenic drugs and alcohol, all of that, I'm telling you, one day I walked to an altar and that blood-stained cross of Jesus Christ, when I called upon him, his blood washed me and it set me free. You're not listening to me, but I said it set me free. He said, not only to the poor, and when you've got no hope, I'll give you hope. He said, I came for the blind, those who are spiritually blind. You made bad mistakes and made wrong choices. You say, God can never use me. Welcome to the club. He said, I'll open your eyes and help you change some things in your life. But you got to want to change some things in your life. You can't use my grace as a means to keep living in sin. You've got to change some things in your life if you want to know what I'm talking about. Don't tell me you can keep living like a heathen and claim grace. Grace is not a means by which, or a license for you to stay in sin. Grace is a means and a measure by which to keep me from sinning. Hey! I said, hey! That side sanctified over here. Amen. What are you saying, preacher? I've seen four people come to these altars with lives messed up and they gave their life back to Jesus. One encounter with Jesus changes their life. And what I say to you is that your life, even though it's bad today, it can end up better if you'll just give Jesus a chance. You say, well, I don't know, preacher. Am I going to have to scream like you? You might, but it'll feel good doing it. Amen. And then you may not. That's all right too. See, a lot of people can't see. That's what Christmas is all about. A Savior that will open your eyes and take your oppression. He'll set you free. He said in verse 19, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. See, so many people think, well, because I've heard the Lord's coming, I don't believe it anymore, preacher. I'm telling you, he's closer than he was 60 years ago. And just because you've heard it 50 years, he's still coming. He's still coming. They didn't have what we've got today. It's the acceptable year of the Lord. You say, I don't feel special. I've come to make you feel special. Just tell your neighbor, say, you are special. You are special. Help me, Lord. You are special. David Pickard, you special. You know that? I love you, my friend. I love you. I mean, you love me. Sometimes I love old Brother Bulldog. He loves me. Brother Larry and Brother Chris, they all right. Brother Wendell, he's got to put up with me every day come the first of the year. Amen. We love each other. What are you talking about, preacher? We've got to start telling them as leaders, the Lord's going to return. If he came the first time and he died on a cross, was buried, and then on the third day was resurrected, then he ascended on high by the angel, a cloudy elevator to ascend to the right hand of the Father. I'm telling you, he's going to return. He's coming again. I want to be ready for him. See, Christmas is about restoration. What I've just read to you is Jesus' mission statement. It's what he stands for. But we have forgotten what it's really all about this season. It's about upgrading your life. See, I'm glad you got a Christmas present. My wife asked me, said, what do you want for Christmas? I said, I really don't want anything. I'm going on a 21-day fast. And so are you. You didn't know it till right now, but so are you. January the 4th, I've done this for years, going to 21-day fast. I fast, I separate myself from all the abstractions, the distractions of the world, and I fast for 21 days. I become a grouch. But that's the only time I'm ever a grouch, is those first 21 days. And the rest of the year, I'm just an angel. Now, all of y'all laughing like y'all believe that. And the first of the year, we all go on a 21-day fast. I ask 21 people to take one day with me or more if you want to fast and pray for me that day so that we can see a move of the Holy Spirit like we've never seen in the life of Faith Assembly of God. See, I want more than what I've ever experienced. And Christmas is about restoration. And we've forgotten that it's about upgrading my life. I want more of God. It's God saying, Ronnie, you're going to need help, and this world and society in Pike County needs help. I've got to go. They're going to need someone. And so Jesus came for you. He came for you. I've got to go. And Jesus left all of the glory of heaven to come down to where we are. In the midst of a suffering world, he pitched his tent, his camp, right next to yours. Just so he would understand everything about me. He understands my pain. He understands my confusion. He understands my anxiety. He understands my depression. He understands the suffering. He understands the joy and the excitement and the loss of a friend. It's as if he stooped over the sapphire seals of heaven and to look at me and to win me back to himself and became what I am so I could become what he is. You see, God's not satisfied with me staying the way I am. He wants to work on me and change me until I become the mirrored reflection of who he is. And when I get to heaven one day, and that's my plan to get there. I said, that's my plan to get there. Well, four or five of y'all want to go with me, but I'm going to get there. I want to remind you, there's a price for redemption. There's a price for restoration. There's a price for... See, my kids tell me all the time, say, Daddy, I want this gift. Jace, I guess it's been a couple months ago, he plays Xbox One. Back in my day, I used to play it, but it was Atari. You know, it had two controllers on it. I can handle two controllers. Now you got a controller, it's got trigger buttons on both sides. You got two joysticks right above the two trigger fingers. Then you got this dial pad. And I'm thinking, then you got this little knob or whatever it is. Man, you have to be Einstein to play Xbox One these days. He came up to me and he said, Dad, I'd really love to have this game. How much is it? Well, it's 50% off, Daddy. I said, how much is it? You know, Daddy, it's on sale. I said, how much? Usually when they start leading me astray like that, I know it's going to cost me something. It's on sale. See, that game cost me something. He got the game. I love to bless my son. He's a good kid. But we're governed by price. Everything costs something. You like it because it costs you something. That new SUV gonna cost you something. That roast you got cooking in your crock pot, it costs you something. But what was the price for Christmas? Have we forgotten of what it cost Jesus to come and do? I know he was Mary's little lamb, but he also was the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He was on a mission. He came to die. So the question is, who benefits the most from taking Jesus home with him? Well, the one that actually take him home with him. The ones who take him from church this morning back into their family are the ones who see the family and their home change. Come on, somebody. Men, we got to be the spiritual leaders. Women, we have to submit to the authority of the house. But together, we make the home work. Amen. If my wife can't vacuum, I vacuum. Or put your kids to work. Amen. They got to do something. You know what I'm saying? Come on. The ones that we take them home, it's the family that we see him changed, amen. If you walk around singing Whiskey River, Take My Mind, more than you sing Jesus on the Main Line, you got to change something. If you walk around singing Highway to Hell, more than Why Can Wash My Sins Away, Nothing But the Blood, something's got to change. Amen. I read a story of an old man who had a son. And the old man and the son, they had a love that they shared. It was collecting expensive art. The old man was filthy rich. And so the son grew up just loving what his father loved was collecting art. They had masterpieces, multi-million dollar paintings in their home, their mansion. And the young son loved to collect, and something came open, the old man bought it, and they had a house filled with priceless art. Well, the boy grows up, becomes a young man in war called, and the father's son enlisted to go serve his country. 2 weeks after serving his country, there was a knock at the door of the old man's mansion, and he got the dreaded news that his son had been killed in battle. The old man would walk through his mansion, they'd see all of these expensive paintings and these priceless collections of art, and he would think of his son, that no one now can share this love with me. And then one day, there was a knock on the door again. There was a young man in a military uniform standing there with a package. He said, "Sir, you don't know me, but," he said, "I know your son." He said, "I'm the young man that your son saved when he was killed in battle." He said, "I've got something for you. I'd like to come in and talk to you if it's okay." It was on Christmas morning. He walks in, sits down, and he hands this old man the package. The old man takes the wrapper off this package. It's a portrait of his son. The soldier was an amateur artist who had drawn his son's, the old man's son's picture just before he was killed. And the old man said, "You've captured my son's likeness, and this is priceless." He goes over to the wall, takes off a multi-million dollar painting, sets it on the floor, and hangs the picture of his son up on the wall, and stands there and looks at it. Well, the next year the old man died, and when he did, the art world got excited because it had gotten out that all of this art is now going to be auctioned off. The world's richest people flew from across the world to buy this priceless art that museums didn't even have. They get there on Christmas morning, all of these people wanting to buy these masterpieces, and they're sitting there with a list of what's going to be auctioned off. A year after the old man died, Christmas morning, the auctioneer grabs the gavel and he slams it down. He said, "The auction has begun. The first painting up for auction is this portrait of the old man's son. Who will give me $100? Complete silence, just like this. One man stood up and said, "We didn't travel around the world to come buy the picture of some old man's son. Get on with the auction. We want to buy these masterpieces. Get on with it." Couple jumped in and said, "That's right. We want to buy this priceless art." And the auctioneer stood up and he said, It is stipulated in the old man's will that the first painting to be auctioned off is the portrait of the son, and this auction cannot continue until this has been sold. The portrait of the man's son has been sold. Who will give me $100? And no one said anything. Finally, the next door neighbor to the old man stood up and said, "You know what? I'll buy the painting. I don't have the money to buy all of this priceless art, but I've got $100, and I'll buy the portrait of the son, because I knew the boy, I knew the old man, and they were my friends, and they're dear to me, and I'd like to remember the son. I'll give you $100. And the story goes that everybody just started clapping, and they were excited that some nut had bought this worthless piece of art. And the auctioneer picks up the gavel and slams it back down. He said, "The auction's over." Everybody jumped up and said, "What do you mean the auction's over? That's the only thing that's been sold is the portrait of the son. We came to buy all of this priceless art." And the auctioneer said, "The rest of the will stipulated that whoever takes the son gets it all." I've come to tell you, Faith Assembly, I don't have millions of dollars of paintings to give Pike County, but whoever takes the son gets it all. You can have your healing. You can have your joy. You can have your peace. You can have your family. If you take home the son of Almighty God, you can have assurance for your soul. You can have a song in the morning. You can have armor to fight the devil. You're not saying nothing, but I came to tell you, when I got saved, I got the son. I got it all. Joy in the morning. Joy unspeakable. Full of glory. Can I have an amen? And when you get the son, you get it all. That's the message of Christmas. If you take the son home, you get it all. When the doctor says you're going to die, I can't die until God says it's over, because I've got the son. The word says, "I shall not die, but I shall live and declare the works of the Lord." And when you take the son, your marriage works out. Your children work out. Your joy is restored. He'll dry a tear. You may shed them, but he'll dry your tear. He'll love you. "Nobody loves me." He loves you. And when you have the son, you have it all. Stand with me. That's the amount that it cost Jesus to come. You say, but Pastor, I know I'm really blessed if I get a certain amount of gifts. That's not Christmas. Angels we have heard on high, echoing through the plains. When you get Jesus, you get it all. You say, so you really believe that preacher? I put my soul on the line. That's the only thing I've got, is my soul. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world? If you can go buy painting after painting that's multi-million dollars of worth and you still lose your soul, how did it benefit you? That's why I tell people, a good church is hard to beat, man. Preach the word, sing the word, love one another. Jesus at Faith Assembly. That's the greatest gift that any man could ever receive. Bow your head with me, would you please? Musicians are coming. Listen very quickly, please. Some of you are here and you're running from God. Through prayer, he told me that there would be some that he's calling. He's working on you. He's been talking to you. He's been dealing with your heart. He's got a purpose for you. He's got a plan for you. And if you were the only person in this room this morning, he would die and come and save you, because you alone are worth the price that he paid. And he's been drawing you. He's been wooing you and telling you that where you are is not where he wants you to be. He's got so much more for you. And you're here and you're listening to me. I can tell you, Christmas is not a feeling. Christmas is a fact. And the greatest fact you'll ever know is that he'll never leave you. He will never forsake you. It's a fact. He'll go with you to the very end of the world. It's a fact. And you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Ron, no one's looking. You say, Pastor, you're talking to me. I want you to lift your hand up and put it right back down. That's all you've got to do this morning. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to do anything. Come on, somebody. I'm preaching to you. You're here. Pray for me, preacher. Anyone? Anyone? Thank you. Thank you. Come on, there's more. Thank you. You got to get it right. Now, after this morning, you're still not going to be altogether perfect. You don't have to be. God, it already is. It was a perfect timing. It was a perfect gift. You just rest in his strength. And you stay plugged into a church and stay plugged in to the prophetic voice. You stay plugged in to a church family that will love you. And everything, it may not be so pleasant, but things are better when I'm around people that love me and support me. Anyone else? Quickly. Let me see your hand. Come on, you got to make a decision to get back on track with God. Come on, you're away, you're cold. You're indifferent in your walk. Anyone? How many of you appreciate the fact that Jesus was your perfect gift? How many of you this morning say, I love God with all of my heart? Can I get you to wave your hand now at me if you love him with all of your heart? Thank you. This is what I want us to do. For those that are comfortable, listen, we got 11 days until the whole world, look at me for just a minute, the whole world is going to stop, literally, because of my Jesus. You know, years ago, I used to beat up on the Baptist. I used to beat up on the Methodist. I used to beat up on the Lutheran, the Catholic. They used to beat up on me. I quit that garbage, because that's exactly what it is. It's just garbage. It's one thing to beat up my brother, and I'm glad God delivered me from that. But the whole world right now is shifting to Allah and Islam, false religion. I'm going to hammer against that one. There is one way to the Father. Jesus said, I am the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. No man comes unto the Father but through me. So I love my other brothers, my other denominations. I love them. Amen. Even if they don't love me, I love them anyway. But false religion, sending people to hell, and I believe there is one, I'm going to preach against that. But you know something? I've learned this, that while we can love one another and yet still stand against the false religions and false gods of our time, ladies and gentlemen, it's time that Pike County awakened to the fact through a local body called Faith Assembly that we don't care your worship style. We don't care about that. We don't care your makeup or your personality. Do you know Jesus? Oh, you're ready to meet Jesus. That's the whole thing. And this morning, I'm going to ask everyone, because in 11 days, the whole world's going to stop. Walmart closes the whole day because of Jesus. Now, tell me of any other world religion that stops because of any other religion or any other. It doesn't for Confucius. It doesn't for Allah. That's why the world hates the name of Jesus so much. That's okay. That's all right. But in 11 days, the world's going to stop. And when it does, Jesus Christ has proven to the world for over 2,000 years that he's a perfect sacrifice. Would you come spend some time around the altar? See, when I can't get anybody to come because they need to get some things right in their life with God, I've learned one thing. We've got to keep the altars moving and working. Keep a fire built on the altar. How many of you believe people should have been in church today, but for some reason they're not here? In Pike County, Mississippi. And while I look around here, our church is filling up. There were those that could have been here. So will you come and join me around this altar and just pray that the real reason of Christmas will begin to radiate from you and I? Because how are they going to hear? They're going to hear it from us. Will you come and say, God, use me as a voice to let everybody know? Because this week, you're going to run into somebody and say, well, I just don't feel Christmassy. So, I don't base my walk with God on my feelings. I base it on the Word of God and the fact that Jesus is the Son of God. And he came for me. Amen? Come on, would you come spend some time around the altar and say, God, use me this morning to tell somebody that it's, you know, even if you don't feel Christmassy, it's not a feeling, it's a fact. And let's spend some time around the altar. Maybe you're coming. Maybe this is just a general way to get you to come. We invite everybody just to come to pray. Use me. Just come use me. Crowd in if you need to. We got them blocked up in the aisleway. Come on. Everybody move up just a little bit more. Come on and just God, use me to tell somebody it's all right if you feel bad. We've got a hope for you. It's okay if you don't feel good. We've got a hope for you. Christmas is not a feeling. It's a fact. Young people, life has got a lot of disappointment for you. And this old gray-headed preacher is telling you that through all of the feeling that you ever feel, Jesus will always be there. He'll always be there. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come this morning. I'm just pouring out my heart. I'm just pouring out my heart because, God, there are times when I'm not in the Christmas mood. I don't have lights on the house. I don't have music playing. I'm not watching any Christmas movies. I don't have money to buy Christmas, and I feel like a failure. Listen to me. You're not a failure. Times are tight for everybody. And if you're going to make it, you've got to have somebody that's going to help you and encourage you. You're going to be okay. You're going to. You may not feel that way today, but I'm telling you, this struggle, this trial, this issue that you've got going on that you're facing, you're not facing it alone. There's a God that loves you. And if you'll give it all to him and trust in him, I promise you, every one of us in here have been through storms and struggles that we thought would never end, but they did. And we can tell you the reason why they did and how we came over is because it wasn't a feeling, it was a fact that all things work together for my good. And Father, we're asking you this morning, as we lift up our voice, Father, as we lift up our heart, use me as a vessel, that as I run into people this morning and next week, God, that they just don't feel the Christmas spirit. Father, that if we get focused on you again, you are the spirit in which we need. You are the reason for the season. Let me commit first to you. First of all to you, Father, as Lord as my life. You're Lord over my life. You're my Savior. You're my God. And you will I trust. Hallelujah. You're my God. I love you and I'm serving you. So let me be an instrument. Let me be a vessel. Let me be a voice to put the real focus on what Christmas is this week. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.